all about the E-flite DRACO episode of the Live Air Hangout. So for those that aren't familiar, this is actually a show that we started last year. Obviously, a lot of people ended up stuck at home, ourselves included, but we really wanted an opportunity to connect with everybody. And so what we did is back then we were doing it weekly, then we switched to bi-weekly. And then coming into this year, we wanted to change the format a bit more to make it a longer show later in the evening that we do once a month so everybody knows it's coming. Or in this case, we let you guys know yesterday because we obviously had a really big product announcement and it makes a ton of sense to follow that up with a show where we can talk about the product, show it off, but also bring in some really special guests. So on the screen with me, joining me this evening is my co-host, Mr. Steve Petrato.
Hey, Jason. Good evening, everybody. Thanks for having me on. Exciting
and
night.
So, yes, Friday night. It's late. It's, I know, after work hours, right?
It's all right. It's good. We got a lot more people on the live. We got a kick butt product to talk about. And we sure, you know, in the green room, we've got a lot of cool faces. So it's going to be awesome. A great show, everybody. Please stick around. Share this feed, you know, share it to your group of people. Get as many people in here and share the love of aviation. And of course, with DRACO, we've got some really cool guests. So, yeah. What do you want to do next, Jason? Where do we go from here?
I think if we're still getting some live viewers kind of up and going here, then I think real quick we'll talk a little bit about who we are, because I think some people that are joining us tonight or that might watch this later who are big fans of Mike and what Mike has done and obviously the full-scale DRACO, Horizon Hobby, we may be new to them. And so I think it's a great opportunity to introduce ourselves. And one of the most exciting aspects about what we do is we help people have fun with hobbies. We've been doing that for the last 35 years. We are the largest manufacturer and distributor of recreational hobby products. Really in our industry, radio controlled hobby products in particular. We have airplanes, helicopters, cars, boats, we have trains, we have models, we got a little bit of everything. And we sell to hobby shops throughout the United States, North America, all over the world. We have offices in obviously the United States and also then in Europe and Asia as well. And so a lot of information on our website, of course, horizonhobby.com. And if you're seeing this live, you may be seeing this on our Horizon Hobby Facebook page. If you haven't already, please do us a favor, like that page, so that way you can follow us on there. You might also be seeing this on the Horizon Hobby YouTube channel. So be sure to also subscribe there, mash that bell so you get the notifications when we drop videos, because we got videos, a lot of videos coming for DRACO still, and you don't want to miss those. And real quick point on that, we have two YouTube channels. We have a Horizon Hobby channel, which is what this is streaming live on now and will live on indefinitely after the fact. And then also we have the Horizon Hobby Products channel. That channel is a little bit more product centric. So that's, for example, where you see the first video for DRACO. You're going to see a lot of the follow-up videos as well. And so be sure to also subscribe there, mash the bell there as well if you haven't already. Tons of videos there as well. So, and then real quick, quick plug for Spectrum as well. So you guys will see, I've got my Spectrum hat on, got my NX8 transmitter here hooked up to the DRACO. We've got some Spectrum smart batteries and smart chargers on display to talk about those a little bit later. Be sure to then also subscribe to the Spectrum RC channel as well. So hopefully I covered everything there, Steve. I think you did, Jason.
People want to know about the plane. So let's cut the marketing mumbo jumbo. Let's jump right into it. We had an incredible launch day yesterday. I think it just broke the internet, as they say. We had this, you know, people knew this was coming for a while. We had a really coy announcement at Oshkosh with Mike a couple years ago, and the project took a long time, and you know what? It needed it. It is one of those projects that Horizon and all of our staff put hours and hours and hours. I was talking to Matt right before the stream, and he was telling me how many flights he had on some of the test models, and it was just mind-blowing. So we'll get to talk to him later today. What a crazy day. Super exciting for the industry, not only for the RC side, but for the aviation industry. I think, you know, joining the two, the awesome stuff that Mike brings to the table, the cool products that we bring to the table, it's a match made in heaven. So it's been super exciting. So, and thanks for all your hard work, Jason. I know you've been on the forums and on Facebook and YouTube answering all these questions out there. So appreciate that as well.
Yeah, I've been excited about it for a long time. And, you know, we've all been excited about it for a long time. And it feels like forever. I think it's really technically been about 2.5 years since we talked about it and then ultimately started it. But it was a labor of love for a lot of people. And we're going to have a lot of those guys on tonight with us. And they can talk about the struggles, but then also the triumphs of this project in the end. And that's pretty exciting for us. And, you know, both Steve and I, we're the marketing guys. So for those that don't know, Steve is the director of marketing on the air side of things, the radio side of things, also the corporate side of things. And I know you've been just chomping at the bit to make sure that that you had the opportunity to help us with some of the videos and things like that, the music in particular. So I'm really excited because of the music that you chose for that track. I want to give you a quick shout out on that. So for those that saw the video yesterday, that was Steve's brainchild. The music is fantastic. I think it really speaks to the product and the excitement surrounding it. For those that like the track, awesome. And you know, that stuff is not easy to find. It's also not easy to license it appropriately. And Steve took the reins on that and handled it for us, which is great.
Yeah, you got to have good music for a good product and an awesome airplane. So I wasn't going to let that one drop. But no, yeah, good stuff. Yeah, the video came together great. I mean, like I said, the whole team here, product development, marketing, purchasing, sales, the whole company's come together on such an announcement like this. And it's just breaking records left and right. And so we're super excited about that. And it's exciting to see the industry this on fire with such a product. So what do you say we kick it up a notch? You want to bring Mike Patey on?
I think we should, if he's available. You know, he's busy always.
Yeah, I think he's giving me the thumbs up. So we'll have our studio team bring him in.
Oh, fantastic. Hello, Mike.
Hi, guys.
How you doing, man?
Fantastic. This is so fun.
Yeah, thanks for joining us tonight. I know you have been excited about this release just as much as we are. And you obviously have a lot more history with the aircraft itself. And man, is it cool to finally have you on here and let all of our fans see you. And, you know, thanks for coming on. Appreciate it.
I couldn't be more excited to be here. I'm just blown away, overwhelmed at how many people have followed my passion in aviation. All of your passion in aviation. And when you first came and asked me about DRACO and building an RC, I mean, I about fell over. I've been RCing for a long time. I got out of for a few years flying the big aircraft and just started flying them again. And it just blew my mind to think that I built a plane that others might want to fly. It's a little more trophy truck, a little more wild, a little unique. And I couldn't believe you wanted to build it when I met you, and to come this far. And then I have to say, along the way, I started to get nervous because so many people said, this better be realistic. This better not be another little cheap toy. And I thought, oh man, I don't want people to be let down. And when you showed me this, and I, you know, obviously I've been involved all the way along since we started 3D scanning every single inch of it. I knew we did the pre-work, but you guys blew me away. I mean, absolutely blew me away. You guys got a clip of me just like, I think it's in one of the videos, I put my head down. I was just in shock seeing it for the first time. And I actually started looking through the rivets, the gas tank filled nozzles, the vent ports for my fuel lines for when I'm sitting on a super steep angled hill and normally the planes would drain the fuel out. All those little details absolutely blew my mind. I couldn't find anything that wasn't absolutely spot on. I'm just blown away. Thank you. Thank you.
No, thank you, Mike. It's been an honor. I know the PD team is on with us in the green room, and we'll have them on here in a short bit. But I know, and I'll let them tell their story, but I know they've been super excited and just working day in and day out to make sure that this is of expectation for not only you, but for all of our fans and for people that are coming into the hobby that, you know, are coming from the full scale aviation side, which is really exciting for all of us. We're sharing the love of RC, but it's going through you. It's brought in a whole lot more actual full scale aviation people. And that's just the best thing we could ask for the RC industry. It's really cool.
Thanks. I've seen it go both ways. I noticed a bunch of guys that were RC specific have been messaging me that they've been watching, and they watched DRACO build from the start all the way to the day I crashed it, and that they've moved into full size. And full size guys, that I couldn't believe how many people said that they're buying their first RC aircraft, but they've been flying full size for 15 years. And I thought, man, it's so cool to see the love of flight. and everyone's starting to blend. And I'm so excited. I can't wait to come up with more things. I want to fly Draco X when I get it done and go land it at some of these RC fields. I have this new dream of some of these little teeny grass strips. I'm going to find some of you out there, and I am going to get permission, and I'm going to come bring Dracos, and I'm going to land the real Draco and fly with all of you guys, because I think that'd be the coolest thing ever.
Be great. You're definitely welcome at RC Fest here in Monticello, Illinois. I know you can get in and out of there. I'm pretty sure it's a pretty 800 foot long strip, I think, plus some. So I think you can get in and out of there, but you're definitely welcome to come there.
We're good.
Yeah.
I think what we might do if he does come is maybe we empty out part of the hangar to make sure he could take off out of the hangar. That would be a cool shot. Just like that mall shot that's, you know, pretty popular.
Sounds good. Well, very good. Well, Mike, I think, you know, one of the questions I have for you is what sort of reaction have you seen out of your crowd specifically? You know, is it shock? Did they expect it? You know, or are they just blown away like we are?
You know, I've seen a mix. So there are a lot that some just never caught that we kind of talked about it briefly. It was right when we first kind of brainchild, let's do this. And they missed that. And so there's a bunch of people that are just flat out floored. They had no idea it was coming. And so I think we emptied some stimulus checks out there. Right off the bat, it went from new furniture to a Draco. But there were a lot of surprise, and then there were a lot of anticipation that were expecting it, have wanted it. And then there were even some that were a bit disappointed it took so long. But I tell you what, the ones that were disappointed and asked every couple months about it, when it came out, I recognized a lot of names, and it has completely changed to, it was worth the wait. It is everything I hoped, you know, and so it's fun to, and it, you know what, to get that much detail. I mean, the suspension and the king shocks, and there's little things that, like the springs and how to get them to work and interact actually true to scale. It's real easy to just grab an off the shelf part and then adapt it. But that's not what happened with this plane. Mm-hmm. Before I looked at it and flipped it and turned it, I went, where did you find this, thinking maybe you pulled something off a truck or a part? And it doesn't. It's not there. Everything I could find is one off. And I can't believe it. Way to go, guys.
I'm looking at it, and I'm trying to think of anything on here that we've actually used on another product. And I think when it comes to airframe parts and hardware, everything is brand new. I don't think there's anything here that's been reused. And some of the electronics are repurposed from past products, but that's really it. Everything outside of those is all new just for Draco.
Yeah. I just put this one together about an hour before this, and flawless build, first of all, but also, I was just blown away with all the fit and finish and the detail. Like you said, Mike, it's just like, you look at this and I've watched all your videos on the Draco as well. And it's like, wow, this is crazy that this looks so good. Every time I pulled the new part out of the box, I was laughing like a little kid, like, wow, look how good this looks. So I know that same reaction, and I hope that same reaction happens with all the customers that have one on pre-order or will eventually buy one. You're just going to get this thing and go, wow, this is on another level that we've never done before. So super cool.
Yes. And it took a long time, and we apologize to everyone who's been waiting so anxiously, but like a few people have said, it was worth the wait. And that's why we took so long to get it done, is because we had to make sure it was right. This is Draco. It's not just another RC model. Everything about it is special and unique. And that's why I wanted to make sure the model was too.
Yeah, no, it's great. So I guess I'm looking at some of the comments here, Mike, and I probably want to address those so we can, you know, while you've got the time, I'm not sure how long you'll be with us tonight, but. Yeah, so one of the ones I saw, and Jason, if you see any, I know you're in the studio, so it's a little harder for you, but one question I saw was, you know, did you have any reservations when we first talked to you? I think you kind of touched on that, but maybe dive into that a little bit further. You know, were you a little nervous, and what sort of things were you worried about us getting right when it comes to building your airplane in a model?
Yeah, when you first talked to me, I wasn't nervous. I was just blown away. Are you kidding me? You want to make a replica of my passion, my dream build that I had thought about for many years. And so, no, I had no reservations. I think it was later that I started to think, did I pick the right guys? Let me do some more research. Ocean Horizon was like awesome, but it was kind of like, I said, yes, let's do it. Awesome. I'm in, you know, how do I help you? Let's just, whatever you need, you can have it. And then later I was like, are they the best place? And so I'm researching. I'm like, yeah. Okay, good. People like Horizon. They do good work. It's still what it was when I was younger and it's the product I bought. So, you know, it went way back when I started flying full size. And I think the last plane I was flying was like 8 Zaggies with my friends, and we were full combat. Just trying to, it was like, let's just knock everyone out of the sky. You know, that was kind of when then I made the transition to full size. And then when you guys brought Draco out, and I've been flying with my son, so I didn't get out of it completely. My kids have come up with RCs, and so my youngest son, Dex, oh my gosh, if you walk into my hangar, that little sticker has filled an entire room with planes, Florida flying, car, trucks, everything. So I've been RCing with him, and he's a far better pilot than I am at this point. I'm excited. I got a little nervous for just a second, and then not, and then every reservation or thought that maybe was it going to be everything we had hoped, it just went out the window when it showed up, and we threw it in reverse in the dirt. I mean, I literally started laughing. I hope you didn't record it and it doesn't end up online. I might have been like 5 years old for like 10 minutes laughing straight. I had water coming out of my eyes. We pounded it, guys, if you're watching, out here on our field. Horizon all came out here to my place. And we went out in these weeds and dirt and rocks. And we're like, well, I don't know where to fly it. We got permission from the airport to fly it at the airport, and had a safety guy with a radio and shut down while we were doing filming. And there was a little patch of dirt, but we started pounding it in and rocking it and going through the ruts and bumps. And I have never had any plane that we could literally beat through the dirt like that. And I was laughing the whole time. And I think one time we landed really long, and I thought, that's it. It's going to go over. We're going to wreck it into the brush. And I huffed it in reverse. I was like, stop. And it was game over. That's the real Draco. I can throw dirt everywhere and stop. That's cool.
Awesome. Yeah, the ESC reversing thing is certainly something new in a way to Horizon and our products with our smart speed controls. But man, does it really add another level of just cool factor to the Draco RC. I've yet to fly this one. Like I said, I just built it. I'm going to probably be going out tomorrow, weather willing, but I'm definitely going to try that out. But for those of the guys that are asking on the stream, yes, it indeed has reversing motor, so you can stop it. And if you watch the video at the end of it, we do a audio off and you can hear it, and it's just, you can hear that motor going wah, and it stops the airplane. It's really cool.
It's a very simple thing, but it really opens the doors to what you can do with the model, just like the full scale. So you can land in places you wouldn't be able to land an airplane this size normally, and if the rollout's a problem, no problem, just slam it into reverse and stop it. Which, it does take some practice, and you'll find that, Steve. It's not like, oh, I just flip a switch and it goes in reverse. No, because then you have to add power. Yep. It's a weird feeling, but I'll tell you, after 6, 10 tries, a lot of guys are going to get caught onto it, and it's amazing how short you can land it. I've been able to land this thing in like 3 feet, if that even, and just stop it on a dime. It's impressive.
The other thing that really stood out, and it kind of is a testament to getting the scale exactly right, which you did. A lot of people may not know, but if you turn that plane perfectly sideways and look at the location of the tires relative to the wing. So Draco had a unique advantage in the STOL competitions, and a lot of people didn't understand why. They always thought it was just the fact that it's reverse. Mm. The front tire in real size is 24 inches further forward than a regular pivot moment on a like Cub. And so what that means is, of course, everything had to shift in the wing location to be able to have that much forward CG on an aircraft. And what that does is, when you're going in the grass, or Draco would go and hit the brakes, not even using reverse, it wouldn't flip over on its nose and take out its prop. It's the most common accident right now in real Cub flying, is people landing short and hitting the brakes and going on their nose. And I've done that with RC planes for a long time. But we got out here in this grass, and you land in the grass without using reverse, and you're in that grass that's thick enough and green enough and deep enough that if you remember the last plane you landed in, you endoed it. And that wheelbase is so far forward that it lands like the real Draco does, and it just kind of cruises right through it, and then you take off again. And I, when we got the scale, I mean, and I don't know, you guys could speak more to this, but when we 3D scanned this aircraft, we had one of the highest end scanners in the Western U.S. sitting in my hangar for days from every angle, and that's why it's so accurate. And for you guys to get it all set up, the battery location, the motor, the center of gravity, where you put the components to make it fly true to the real Draco. The first time I flew it, I was just blown away. It looks, feels, and flies like Draco flies. So wow. Good job. It's just cool.
Well, speaking of that, I think, Jason, you want to pull in the PD guys too so we can get some of that commentary while
yeah,
we're
Yeah, I think we should definitely bring in the guys that worked on this project, put the most passion into it. And then real quick, because I've seen this comment a lot. I'm, you know, some guys are very excited that it's a foam aircraft. Some people are bummed out that it's a foam aircraft. And I think one of the points that I'd like to make is the fact that we 3D scanned the airplane gave us an opportunity to see every curve, every nook, every cranny, every detail. And when we saw that, there was just no way you can replicate that in a wood model or in a composite model. The only way to do that is in a fully molded foam model. So that's why we chose this. We also chose the larger size that we did because it allowed us to get all those details on there. Again, all the curves and the cracks and the crevices and the handles and everything we could possibly put into this model, we could only have done it in fully molded EPO foam.
Yeah. I know a lot of guys want to see a giant scale Draco, you know, even more so a big balsa one, but that may be in the future. We never know, but it is going to be a little bit harder with that to get all those little details right. So I guess without further ado, let's get Matt and David in here. We got Mr. Matt Andren and David Payne. Welcome to the chat, guys.
Hey guys.
So for those that don't know, these two guys were the what we call the PD guys, the product developers on the project, Mr. Foam or Mr. Matt Andren, and David Payne, who's both have been with us for years and years and years and probably predate my existence at Horizon. But you guys have hours and hours and hours in this airplane. Thanks so much for all your hard work. I know you guys are excited for the launch and happy to have you on the show tonight. Thanks for coming on.
Thanks for having us.
Glad to be here.
I'd like to point out that David it's just David.
He doesn't have his last name up there. I can fix that.
Just David.
is two names. It's Matt Patey and Mark Patey. So if I need to use the restroom, my twin's wearing the same shirt. He's going to just roll right in. So,
well, I guess let's start with Matt. I mean, Matt, you were kind of telling me before the show how many flights you had on this airplane just in testing, whether it was testing landing gear or just power systems. I mean, talk a little bit about that process for you and what kind of detail goes into this kind of airplane.
I mean, we actually got the first sample of winter of last year. So we've been flying it basically since then. You know, once we tested the sample and found out it was kind of ready to go and we tooled it, man, we flew that tooled sample so many times. I mean, we probably have thousands and thousands of flights on some of these samples. Mm-hmm. And I did 75 takeoffs and landings in 2 days. So, you know, we really, really went the extra mile on this airplane to make sure it was right. Everything worked the way we wanted to, worked the way the real Draco works. You know, the shock absorbing landing gear, the power system, just the functionality, the look. You know, we really strive to make that the best we could on this particular model.
Awesome. And David, what was kind of your role with the project? I know you guys worked together pretty heavily, but what was kind of your role during the whole time?
Yeah. So Matt and I worked really, really together quite a bit on it. You know, so we both do a lot of the CAD work when it comes to things like that, the aero design work. We really work together, I would say, for quite a bit of this, truthfully. You know, there's so much that goes into a project like this, like Matt said, and we even spent, you know, there's a lot more in the background on this, like the Bindafly, for instance, the programming and the code work for the Bindafly. There's a lot of stuff going on in the background that, you know, is great. When Mike and I were flying together, you know, we started comparing notes of what the real airplane did and what the model did, and they're very, very similar as far as some of the, let's call them quirks that they have. So it was cool to work through all of that. And
you mean extra special unique qualities?
Okay.
Well, I guess, Mike, let's talk a little bit about that. What are some of the things that we, or that you know on full scale Draco as far as its flight characteristics that we might expect on the model?
Yeah, so Draco has a lot of elevator, and there's a lot of trim that is needed in some of the different flight characteristics. Draco, because it's originally designed as a slower stall aircraft. Now, it used to have a flight envelope, a stall speed of 57 knots, and a top speed of 110. So it only had a 60 some odd knot total envelope of bottom to top end, and most bush planes are. Now, when I redesigned the wing, redesigned the tail, the section, the rudder, elevator, completely changed the airfoil, I thought we dropped the stall speed from 57. Mathematically, it should have gone into the mid to low 40s at best. And we got almost 10 knots below that. On the top end, we got it up to almost 180. So we took the flight envelope from 30 in the 30 mile an hour range to 180 mile an hour range. It's one of the broadest movements. So wow. To make an aircraft that can fly fast, but also have a high camber wing and a big enough elevator to fly ultra slow, was an extremely challenging aerodynamic task. And I don't know how to emphasize that. It was unbelievable amount of pushing the envelope on all flight control systems. And so when we started talking about what it would take, the things that we're going to do, that was something, you know, we were curious. How is that going to work out in translation? And it kind of helped push, I believe, to the bigger model to help make it get a little closer to true scale. And then it created some of these quirks you're talking about. But what's funny is they're not really quirks. You adjusted everything and made it fly so good. I noticed how much elevator I have, and you just need to slightly adjust the difference from ultra slow to ultra fast, because the RC Draco has a broad range as well. And the other day I saw someone flying, I've been watching some videos about it. Someone hovered it and just sat there, and then they went backwards into the wind and just sat there. And I was watching, I said, okay, that is Draco true to scale. I've done that in Draco up at altitude at a nice wind and came to a complete stop, zero ground speed, and backed it up. And actually watched somebody do that in the first day it got out was so cool. You guys nailed it. You nailed it. It has quirks, but it's a wide range airplane.
I think that's a really good point. You know, a lot of even the models, right? They're very comfortable at higher speeds, or they're very comfortable at lower speeds. Many times their personalities only fit one side of that, right? You know, a lot of our high speed airplanes, right? They're not the most, you know, they're not that simple to land or something like that, or fly slow. But yeah, true to that, I agree. The Draco, wide open throttle, it's just as happy as it is just cruising around or you know, flying at basically zero in the wind. Yeah.
Yeah, and I know, David, when I flew the model a while back, you were explaining to me, you know, all the things that are kind of going on behind the scenes that the customer, the pilot, is not going to necessarily know. And, Mike, you had mentioned the trim settings, and I think that's one of the things you worked tirelessly on with Matt to get it so that it felt normal in fast and in slow. And there is some mixing going on there, but it mm-hmm. doesn't – you don't even notice it. And for me – you know, I'm nowhere near your level of pilot skill, you know, David, but I was just like, wow, this feels like I'm flying a Cessna as far as, you know, as far as like our Carbon Z Cessna, right? It just is neutral. Everything feels good and clean at full speed and at low speed. And that there's a lot of stuff going on behind the scenes that you don't even know.
And that's something that's actually very challenging in the RC world, right? And Mike can attest to this, but in a full-scale airplane, you're always trimming the airplane for speed, right? You're always trimming for speed and adjusting the airplane to that. In the RC world, we don't really do that, right? The customer expects – the same thing out of full power that they expect out of, you know, glide. And that's a huge aerodynamic challenge. I mean, really. So yeah, we've incorporated a lot more into the Draco that kind of takes care of a lot of that in the background.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. I think traditionally we would address those with thrust angle and incidence and, of course, even CG to a degree. But like you guys have pointed out, this airplane has such a wide envelope. It was not really practical to cheat some things to work well in one aspect, because then it would have a substantial negative impact on the other side of things. So, you know, we came up with the best compromise between the two and then tweaked a few things in between. And, you know, that's something we might get into more details down the road. But I think once guys get these out and fly them, they're going to see it's nice because it doesn't change substantially between full throttle and low throttle, in part because of some of those mixes we got going on in the Bindify basic version.
Yeah. One of the questions that came up here, and I'll phrase it a little differently, but I'll start with Mike. You know, when it comes to landing Draco, you know, with the suspension setup, you know, did you typically prefer to do kind of a 3-point, you know, mains first or tail? You know, what was your preferred method? I know sometimes out in the backcountry there isn't a preferred method other than getting it down safely, but I mean, what are some of the landing characteristics there with Draco?
That was actually something I was really excited to see. So I'll answer the question first. I think about the RC. So on the on real Draco, I always landed 3-point to tail first. I like to come down, and that's as slow as you're going to get it. And it has such a great attachment. The leading edge slat is a slightly different leading edge slat than conventional slats, and it's located different specifically for high angle of attack for low speed landing. And so I like to land 3-point. Sometimes they'll tell first. What I really was curious about, and that could get Draco in no wind, if you're wondering, is takeoff and landing is within 3 feet every time. Both. Sometimes you have a plane that can take off, it takes a long time, it can land short or vice versa, but you're only as good as the worst of the two evils. And Draco with 78 feet on both ends, give or take 3 feet. Ground roll to take off on a full flight. And so you always land tail first to hit that mark. And you could land mains. And if it was a little windy, I still would tend to go tail first. But when the real one came out, I thought, I'm not sure if this thing is going to be able to hold as high of an angle attack and that slat work in a small configuration and actually have the tail drag first. That's a kind of a cool mark of a lot of the really high performance bush planes. They're kind of hard, and I'm not talking about pointing it up and hanging on a propeller. I'm talking about the wing doing the workload and the air staying laminar. Draco could drag its tail on the ground and then fly away. And not many aircraft could do that. And the first time we saw that, we got out, I asked that question, and David went out and did it. Right off the bat, he's like, well, let's try it. And all of a sudden, I watched this RC airplane slow down with very little wind. I mean, almost unrecognizable. And he comes down, and the tail wheel is dragging along the grass. And then the main tires were almost a little more than a tire width still above the grass, tire height above the grass. And it was hanging on it. And that is exactly the alpha that I can hang, and much higher it would start to break. And to see the real plane do it the same way just blew my mind. Absolutely blew my mind.
That's awesome. So David, you're a tailwheel endorsed full scale pilot.
Yes. So
you kind of had some of that experience too. But what's kind of your take on RC Draco?
My take on RC Draco is it's just a blast to fly. As you said, I'm very much a pro tailwheel guy, I guess you would say. That's where my passion is for sure. And yeah, the airplane is it's a lot of fun to fly. It handles extremely well. You know, the landing gear allows it to handle a lot more than what most airplanes could handle. You can throw a lot more at it. You can land, I don't want to say anywhere, but really dang near anywhere, right? I mean, we took it to some pretty crazy places while we were at Mike's, and Jason can attest to this. We looked at and went, I don't know. It went right through it. It you know, and it really didn't care. I mean, that's kind of a really cool feature to have. Between that and the reversing, it almost allows you, like Mike said, you can kind of control, your environment where you can land really easy and, you know, take off. It doesn't even know the difference, right? You just throw the power to it and it leaves.
Punch it. Yep. Yep. Well, and I think that's something that, it's important to probably point out that the takeoff short, very easy, but landing short, the airplane can do it, but it is going to take the right skills. Not every pilot's going to be able to do it the first time. Just like I'm sure not every pilot could have flown the full scale Draco the way that Mike did, especially after you got some time on it. But I've got a question that I want everybody to answer. And I think it's a tough one because I wanted to find out, like, what was the biggest challenge when it came to developing the full scale for Mike and then ultimately the models, the model now for the PD guys?
Okay, so the full scale for me was the aerodynamics, for sure. Changing the wing as drastic as I did. I've done wing designs in the past on some other aircraft, and of course I'm doing my most radical on the next coming aircraft. Scrappy's gonna have the craziest wing I've ever done by far. But I took a plane that already existed and then completely changed the shape, but I'm stuck with the back half of the airfoil and I'm altering the front half and then altering the tail, rudder, elevator. And when you're trying to blend one start to another finish, it was a big challenge. I would have thought it might have been the turbine, but I've done so many turbine conversions that I feel right at home putting jet engines, turboprops on the aircraft. So I would say probably the aerodynamics, trying to push that envelope from the 30s to the 180 mark, or 30 mile an hour range to 180 mark. That was a challenge, and fortunately it worked.
Matt, what about you? What was the most challenging part of the project? If he's there, maybe his internet's not doing so hot tonight.
Yeah, it's looking a little
choppy there. We'll go to
the landing.
Maybe not.
Oh no!
Okay. I think it's hung a little.
We'll come back to you, Matt. All right, David, let's let you. We'll come back.
Yeah. So I think the biggest thing that was in the back of my head the whole time was the accuracy, right? To capture that same level of passion and inspiration and detail that Mike did. You know, I mean, I think that's what is so special about Draco is just it's so unique. And you know, there's a lot of airplanes that they lend themselves to when we do them. You know, we can just kind of do them as a very clean, very simple airplane. They have a neat little trim scheme, but they do well that way. This one would have never, in my opinion, done well that way, right? If we'd have kind of went, you know, very simple and hadn't put all the effort into it from all the, I mean, there's 17 lights in this thing, and you know, and the cockpit and the dash lights up and the, you know, the exhauster chromed instead of just painted silver, and there's just so many things that we could go on and on about the, you know, every single detail in it. And I think that to me was the important part, right? Is to make sure that it still had that same character that the real one had.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Matt, I think you're back. Hopefully, let's try you.
Yeah. How do I sound?
Sound okay. Yeah. Your video is a little choppy, but that's okay. We might just turn your camera off for a minute. So you don't have some, but go ahead.
Yeah, that'll work for me. I would say probably the landing gear, you know, kind of getting on the technical side thing. I would say that took probably the most time and effort. Testing, going out there and literally trying to break it with slamming the airplane in where you destroy it. You know, you kind of hit hard, but you know, you're trying to test it as a hard landing would be and make sure it survives what most people would expect it to survive. And I think we far exceeded that. I mean, we have some landings where the thing drops in from head height that blew our minds that the gear even survived at all. So it's been a fun challenge to make that work as scale as it does. That it absorbs, it does, it works accurate to the real airplane. And there was a myriad of other challenges, but I would say that was probably the big one that we wanted to get the most correct for this airplane, because it's such a big part of it.
Yeah,
I think one of the last delays in the project was related to the landing gear. So, and I think this is something Mike can actually speak to because he saw the finished landing gear sitting on the table as we were getting ready to put the model together to fly with him. And I think he was impressed to see that it ended up being a fully molded carbon fiber landing gear. And it's not just like, you know, a sheet of carbon fiber. It's basically custom made specific to fit this model and to handle the loads that it's under. And, you know, in our earlier models, we had aluminum landing gear and it kind of worked, but we actually stopped the project and delayed it a few months to make sure that we got this custom made carbon gear right.
Yeah, for sure. When we were putting it together and we started calling out carbon fiber parts, for those who like to watch my videos, I'm kind of addicted to carbon. So if I have a drug, it's black and woven. And so to actually start assembling it, seeing the carbon fiber in that gear, and then, I tell you what, I tested that gear on the time we spent together flying it during some of the pre-launch, and I'm blown away. It had been the real Draco, I'd erect it again. Oh, it was awesome, guys.
And to actually kind of point out that it's not just the landing gear. There is a lot of internal carbon in that aircraft. There really is. There's a tremendous amount of spar structure, not only in the wing, but actually in the fuselage, the motor mount area. It ties all the way through the cabin so that the clear windows and all of that could be worked out. And it literally goes all the way through the fuselage, ties into the tail. There's a tremendous amount of internal structure in there.
Yeah, I think that's one thing. It's good you point that out, David. I mean, a lot of guys don't think that having that clear canopy, a clear cockpit, really would technically take away rigidity from the fuselage. It's, you know, it's not glass, and you have to kind of figure that out. So having that carbon fiber run through the whole model is vital for the fuselage strength, for sure.
Absolutely. You know, those clear windows, I mean, they make the airplane look amazing, but in true reality, if you just put the clear windows in there, it would just be a limp noodle, truthfully. The wing would not be tied to the fuselage very well at all.
Yeah.
Yeah, you almost need to do it like a full-size airplane, you know, where you have structure tying the top to the bottom. You know, I mean, just, you know, you have the steel tube structure. This is a carbon tube structure. I mean, that's the way you have to do it to make it look right and have a clear cockpit and all the right, you know, openings and windows and stuff like that.
Yeah. I'd like to bring up something that hasn't come up yet. And it's a little bit, I'm going to just go ahead and mention my crash because it's going to come back to what you guys did on this aircraft. So, you know, my crash was a series of bad choices on a bad day. And I totaled it and I walked away. I mean, that plane is gone. If you haven't seen the video, it's out there. Go check it out. I didn't know at the time, and I don't mean to get on this tangent, I didn't know how strong the wind was that hit me at the time. And it was my fault. I shouldn't have been taking off that wind. I hold to that for every day the rest of my life to make better choices. But when I taxied out that day, it was 15 gusting, 20 knot winds. The NTSB said that they actually watched, the FAA and the NTSB were watching my takeoff when I totaled it. Several planes in front, several planes behind me on the ramp. When I hit the throttle, and I should have turned it into the wind, didn't. I didn't want people to think I was being reckless driving sideways on a runway straight at it. Bad choice of mine. I should have just got off. But I went to 47 gust for about 20 seconds. Wow. And I rolled it over, and this is the point I'm getting at. I didn't mean to talk about the crash, but it rolled over, and it hit this wingtip carbon fiber skid I made. And at one point, I'm going to make a video. I have footage of the crash scene before we boxed it up and the trace and how the plane dug into the ground when I totaled it. And this big carbon fiber skid out the side, people don't realize how fast. In the video, if you watch it, you see the plane turns away from the camera. Now, when you lose the camera going across ways and it turns away, you don't have reference of speed anymore. Draco can get from 0 to 80 miles an hour in seconds, literally seconds. And I went full throttle and it rolled the wing. I tried to get underneath it. I didn't want to tumble. And that wind got my back at 47 on a plane that is now accelerating to 80. My impact was like at 115 to 120 miles an hour when it dug, when I started dragging in. That left wing went, hit that ground. And I watched, looked out that left window as the gear tucked underneath the belly and we rolled down onto that wing. And I was waiting for the plane to do what most planes do. I'm on search and rescue. I've been going to the unfortunate crash sites. I volunteer with my twin brother search and rescue on our helicopters for coming up on 20 years. And I go to these crash sites, and usually when they go down on one wing, that wing digs in the ground, and it turns, and then it tumbles. And that's the end of the game at 120 miles an hour. With 100 gallons of jet fuel on board, it would have been a really interesting ride. But I looked out that window, and you hear when things go bad, time slows way down. And you feel like you're watching an eternity-long movie in fractions of a second. And I looked out, and I saw this carbon fiber skid jumping across ditches, skiing. It looked like a slalom ski through glass through rough water, just cutting through, and that wing sliding. And that plane just stayed straight and just slid out. It never hooked. And it never turned, and it never cartwheeled me. And I think it saved my life. And Scrappy's going to get the same thing. When I went back and filmed the post-crash, the two-inch wide trench, a couple inches deep in that terrain, going through ruts and divots where that wing should have hooked the mounds, and it just skipped across them. And I'll get a video out of that sometimes. You can see that track. And so when I saw that you guys had decided to put that wingtip stinger on there, you have no idea what that meant to me. I think that thing literally, I firmly believed it saved my life. And when I was out playing with it, and I never said anything to you guys, it got a little windy. I got a little crazy, and I was zigzagging it back and forth. And I rocked it up on its wing. And I was laughing. I was literally just laughing, having the time of my life. And then I was just hucking it around, and I got up on a wing, and it slid across the grass, and then just went back down. Exactly, just the wing didn't break off, but it bounced on that stinger and went back down on its wheels, and then I just flew away. And it was, I don't know how to describe how that made me feel. To see that you guys put that on there, and that when I mentioned it, you guys talked about how many times in some of your really crazy, aggressive dirt rock pounded down the hillsides that some of you have seen the videos, that little clip where you're coming off that hill and rock, you're going down a slope on a side cant, and I can't tell, and I gotta pause it, but it looks like it skips that skid on that dirt. And I don't know if it's in that footage, but I know for sure it's in other footage. And it just bounces it right back up, which was the intent. And so thank you for going so far as to put a little upright skid, tip stinger, that bounces the plane back on its wheels so you don't cartwheel your RC plane when you're landing in really, really crappy stuff. It's just amazing. I'm sorry, I went off on a tangent, but
no, it's
amazing. Cool. Amazing.
Great insight. Yeah.
And you pointed out something that, you know, admittedly, you know, Jason can attest to this. He was standing on the side of that hill too. That shot took, I don't know, multiple takes, and multiple takes. That airplane was on both wingtips as it was sliding down that hill. Yeah, it's actually really durable. It's a lot of fun.
Well, so here's a good question. I think it sounds like we know one of Mike's favorite features of the full scale. So what are favorite features that Matt and David have for the model?
Matt, you want to take this one?
For me, yeah, sure. For me, it's the wing. I mean, I'm a Stoll guy. I love the wing is set up on this thing. I want to take one and put a 9-channel receiver in it and get the ailerons drooping like the real Draco does to see if it can get even slower just for more fun. But that wing is amazing. The fact that you were able to, you know, extend the pad. I mean, all that stuff just makes it so neat. The leading edge droop, the slat, the everything you got going on it is just so neat on that wing. So that's probably my favorite part of this airplane.
I think mine is probably the, you know, I remember vividly the first year we watched this at Oshkosh, you know, and I think all of us in the, you know, RC side of things went, we have to have an RC Draco, right? But watching Mike land with all the lights going and the big four-bladed prop and the high alpha kind of angle of attack like he was talking and like Jason's doing there, you know, the wing, the lights on the bottom of the wing flashing back and forth, just that appearance and that, you know, character that airplane had. Now we can do that with the RC one, and the RC one, in my opinion, when you're flying through the air, you can replicate that now. And it's, to me, I just love its presence in the air.
Yeah, I know you didn't ask me, Jason, but I'll give my thoughts. I just built this one behind me, and you know, and I know David and Matt will snicker when I say this, but I remember early in the process, I was like, guys, we got to make sure we get the King Shocks right. We have a King Shocks license. We got to make sure we do this. You know, we have King Shock cars and the Losi lineup, and to me, like, that was one of those defining, really, like, what the heck features on real Draco, and it's so cool. When I saw it in person at Oshkosh, that was the first thing I looked at, and to see it come to life on the model. We talked a little bit about the landing gear, but even just the tail wheel, I mean, all of that just looks, it looks so cool, and it's something you just have never seen on any other airplane, but any RC airplane. And Jason was flexing the shocks, and if you just pushed on that tail, I mean, look at the action you can get out of that tail. It's just incredible to me. So that's my favorite feature. I'm sure I'll have a different list of things when I go fly it tomorrow, but that when I first flew the earlier samples, that was definitely one of the things I was excited to see come to life on the production model. What about you, Jason?
So I love the detail overall. It's just an airplane that every time you look at it, you see something else that's on there that you don't see on a typical RC model. So it's a combination of the rivets, the you know, the clear windows, of course, the cockpit, the lights all in the right locations, doing the right thing. The fact that you can turn the lights to different settings so they can flash or you know, it can be off. And then actually something that I probably have pointed out a few times to people is that backup light. And you can turn that on and off. And what's cool is if you do the right mixing, which we're going to have available, you can actually have that come on when you put the airplane into reverse. So it's a very simple thing, but a backup light is just so cool.
Yeah, the lighting system on that. And David, I know you and Matt, I mean, was that something that took a while to kind of figure out, or I assume it was, since it's super detailed.
Yeah, Matt and I sat in a room and we were like, okay, we have, like, we started counting all the lights on the Draco, and he's like, Matt's making this list, and we're like, how can we make all of this work off of one channel? You know, it's like, it's not going to work off of one channel. Yeah, we decided very quickly that it was going to have a controller in it that could drive some of this.
Well, one of the questions I saw go ahead, Matt.
I was just going to say, we wanted it to be, you know, accurate and controllable like Mike could do in the real airplane. You know, we wanted to turn on and off the landing lights, turn on and off the reverse lights, you know, all that stuff. We wanted it to be accurate. I mean, all the way down to having a lit instrument panel, which is one of my favorite lights in the airplane, actually.
Yeah, Jason, can you get a shot of that light panel, the Garmin panel in there?
Yeah, let's see if we can get in there.
I can kind of see it, but I don't know.
Yeah, if you can kind of see it there on that main camera.
Yeah.
Maybe just, Alan can help us with a close-up shot. In. There is that cockpit. If I turn it just right, you can see. Look at that.
Yeah, it's just that detail right there is awesome. The fact that it lights up in there, so cool. Well, couple comments here I wanted to kind of address, and maybe we can get an answer from Mike as well. But I think one of them was there any kind of thing that we had to do? This is for the RC guys. Was there anything that we had to do to the airplane to, you know, make it fly better for an RC that didn't quite fit, or is it truly a scale outline through and through? I know we talked about 3D scanning it, but is there extra washout? Do we have to adjust the size of the elevator? I mean, what sort of things do we have to, and I hate to use the word cheat, but we use that often in the model world where it's like, hey, this, if we put this exact on the model, it may not work perfectly, but if we cheat it by just a little bit, it'll be that much better. So is there anything like that going on with this guy? Matt or David?
Yeah. So,
you want to start, David, or I'll go ahead.
Either one of us. I will admit it's not exactly 100% scale. Mostly it's in the tail. The tail, the horizontal tail especially, is a good bit bigger than, and that honestly, in it's almost 100% of the time when we do a scale airplane, we're going to have to enlarge the tail. When it comes down to shrinking models and making them fly well at this size, that is almost 100% of the time something that's going to happen. But the tail is exactly scale. It's just slightly bigger than what it would have been.
So maybe maybe that's something Mike will have to incorporate into Draco X.
You know, Draco X's tail is slightly bigger in the days. I have not started building it, but in the computer, Draco X is a little bit bigger tail. But that wasn't because the original needed it. By any means, I had all kinds of elevator. The original tail was bigger than the original aircraft. But it's because DRACO X is going to have nearly 1,000 horsepower instead of 680. So I need more rudder.
It's gonna be faster.
It's going to be even faster on the top end. So we need a little more pump on the back end. So
awesome.
Yeah. Well, I was going to say that interesting fact about tails on RC models is that we found that a lot of full-scale models, and maybe David, correct me if I'm wrong on this, but a lot of full-scale models, the area of the stab, horizontal stab, is usually 12 to 14, maybe 15%. But when we scale a model down, you can't scale down air. So the Reynolds numbers require us then to, you know, basically increase the size of the stab to get the same effectiveness. So we end up somewhere between, I don't know, anywhere from 15 to 20%. Which is usually, again, 4 or 5% more than the full scale.
Yep, absolutely. Spot on. You can't shrink air, unfortunately.
I haven't figured out a way to do that yet. Matt, what were you going to say?
It goes back to what David was mentioning earlier about not being able to have a trim wheel on an RC airplane where you can actually fine tune it. You know, a bigger stab helps the plane trim better because it has more authority. So that really helps on an RC model.
Okay.
And I will say the RC model, for sure, when you pull that elevator stick, you feel that elevator is very, very effective on DRACO, on RC DRACO, much more so than most of our STOL aircraft and certainly than a more traditional aircraft as well.
I got to say there's one area that, well, there's a couple areas, but on someone asked if it's how it is in aerobatics, but you guys would be better to answer that. But I got to tell you one thing. DRACO was not an aerobatic, but when I got a hold of the RC, oh my gosh. I mean, we were just hucking it everywhere. You know, the real DRACO would never do that. But I got a good laugh at making DRACO do things that I would never do sitting inside of it. That's for sure.
I think, for the most part, the RC DRACO is actually, I would say for what it is and all of the things that are going on with it, the design, the airfoil, everything, I think it's actually very aerobatic. It actually snaps extremely well. It'll hold a knife edge. You know, the only thing it probably doesn't like very well is inverted flight, and obviously due to that wing, that is a part of it. It will do it, but it's not its favorite maneuver. Let's say that. Yeah.
Yeah, it can fly inverted, and if you're careful, you can get it pretty low as long as you're comfortable. You know, carefully pushing out and or rolling over to get back upright. But it's not intended to be an aerobatic airplane. You know, the goal is to look like the DRACO, fly like the DRACO. But there is a little bit of icing on the cake too, because, you know, it'll hover on the prop with the 6S battery. You can do snaps, you can do rolls and basic loops, and yeah, even some knife edge too. You guys might see that in that kind of opening clip in our video that we published yesterday, a little bit of a kind of a side slip knife edgy thing that it's doing that I'm pretty sure Mike probably didn't do much with the full scale.
It slips very, very well, which is like a big favorite of mine, the whole tailwheel thing, and, you know, side slipping, especially you get the sunlight just right, all the lights on, and you're kind of slipping into land. To me, that's like, that's the moment there. It's really cool.
I have a question.
All right.
So this is something I've been wondering. So if any of you have seen the videos that I did for GoPro with the professional wingsuit guys, where they jumped out of our helicopter and flew down and grabbed my wing. So we were dissimilar flight, high speed, low speed, helicopter and DRACO, and then paired in mid-flight, and they grabbed my wing. To do that maneuver in the real DRACO was extremely challenging, because I had to throw it into reverse, nose it straight to the ground, full flap, and add power in reverse, which put a big mushroom wrong way air in front of the plane that blanked most of my tail control surfaces. So it took several days of practice at real high altitude to fly DRACO at full power, not full power, but powered up in beta reverse to descend at a rate that a wingsuit could pair. And to do that, it blanked so much of my tail that the stick was in my gut, even though I pointed down, which should pull you up. And my rear elevator could just get out of the mushroom cloud and tickle the real air that wasn't destroyed. And so my stick against my chest tickling the real air is how I maintained control in a straight down reverse prop blast. It was really a unique, fun thing to do, and they grabbed a hold. But I never thought, and it's the only thing that's killing me, that when we were out playing, getting ready for this with the plane, I never thought to try it or ask you guys to try it. Have you tried putting it in reverse in a down flight to simulate a insane sink rate and maintain control?
Absolutely. It is almost the exact same as what you're describing. You know, if you use just a little bit of it, you're going to be kind of basically stick all the way back, you know, little bit of control. But if you go full power, it's a whole balloon and you're pretty much along for the ride, right? It's descending rapidly at that point. But if you manage it correctly, you know, Matt and I both and all the PD guys, everybody, you know, that was one of the early on things that was like the whole, we really had a lot of fun with it. And of course we were testing landing gear during this time, right? But it's that whole timing thing of when you can hit the reverse and kind of use that as just that last little bit to slow you down right before you touch down. So we would do down lines with reverse on. You'd come out of the reverse long enough to flare the airplane and then get right back in the reverse to stop you when you touch down. So it'll become a game once you start trying it. Yeah.
Well, I'm dying to see what people do. I hope some people get a couple Dracos together or a couple other aircraft and do some stole drag racing and see how good people can get at that magic transition from flight to full beta while you're touching down, and see some of those drag race full stop, flip the plane around, drag race back to the original line and stop. A matter of fact, I've been trying to figure out how to give away some more Dracos without, just as a gift, not any one manner. I'm gonna come up with something. Maybe that would be an idea. If any of you that are watching this have ideas, I'm gonna buy a bunch more Dracos and come up with some more creative ways to give away Dracos. If you guys have any ideas of what I could do, I'm having so much fun. So many people love this plane and are sharing it and have the passion of flight. What can I do to create ways that people could win Dracos where they don't need to buy a Draco, they can just win one from me? Maybe put some comments on here or hop on my YouTube channel and watch. I'm going to come up with some ideas, and I hope you guys can all help me, any of you. And I'll find a way to give away a bunch more Dracos. You don't have to buy anything to do anything to win it. But I want to know what's the creative way to do it to help those who can't afford to buy a Draco get a Draco from me. So if you got ideas, please send them to me. I'm going to do it.
Yeah, and for those of you watching, we've got all of Mike's information scrolling on the bottom of the screen. So we got his website there, his YouTube channel. So definitely go make sure to subscribe to Mike on YouTube and like him on Facebook and Instagram as well. Give him all the love. I mean, without his grace of letting us scan his airplane, we wouldn't be here tonight. So yeah, definitely go, you know, show some love to Mike and his channels. But yeah, we appreciate that, Mike. As far as giving away models, people love free stuff, and what better free item to get than a RC Draco?
Yeah, I agree with that wholeheartedly, and hopefully we can figure out a way together. But I do have an idea of a contest that maybe either one of us can run, which is potentially, I would love to see someone put functional brakes on the RC model. And on top of that, I would love for someone to put a functional door as well. I think that would be really cool. And if we see that, I'm not sure if we give them another Draco or something else, but I think that would be pretty impressive.
Yeah, I thought about there's some at least for me, they're my most fond memories of some of the things I did with Draco, some of the stole contests or events or the wingsuit stunt. Matt, someone needs to get some little wingsuit dudes and tape them onto their Draco wings and fly it and send me a picture, because you'll make my life. I don't know.
That's a really good idea.
I don't have any, but, or maybe the thing to do is put out a contest for people that maybe do have, I want people that don't have Dracos, I want you to get Dracos from me. People that do have Dracos, maybe you can reenact some of the stuff I've done in past videos with your Draco and send them to me. And maybe I can send you another Draco. I'll figure out something. One of your friends that can't afford a Draco. You know, that would be really cool. If you have one, maybe you can win one and give it to your buddy that you want to go flying, but you know he maybe won't be able to afford one this month. Maybe we can find a way to get him one.
Definitely. Yeah. I'd love to see some of the reenactments in RC. It's
there it is on my screen behind me.
Yep. Oh, yeah. So they got to be blue wingsuits. All right.
Blue and red.
Awesome. Well, I was trying to go through some of the comments as we were chatting here.
I think there's a lot.
There's a lot of them. And I apologize for those of you guys that have asked the same questions over and over again.
Yeah.
But we're trying to catch all that. Matt, do you want to chat a little bit about, you had mentioned the putting a different receiver in it. I know some folks are kind of, quote, we just lost Matt's video. Maybe that'll be better. Well, yeah, you're still there. You know, what sort of things can you look for when you kind of upgrade or increase the channel count with certain functions that you might want to get out of it? Uh-oh, we lose Matt again.
I think he's hung again.
Matt, just turn your camera off. Maybe that'll help your stream.
I'm thinking that what he's thinking, and maybe David can chime in on this also, is that with the Bindify basic version, you have the six channel receiver. So you have both ailerons plugged into a channel. You have both flaps plugged into a channel. But in theory, with an eight channel, nine channel receiver, you'll be able to plug your ailerons in separate channels. And then you can mix your ailerons with your flaps to have that full span flap effect that the full scale had, which if you look at the full scale, one important point is that the ailerons don't go down as far as the flaps. And I'm very curious, maybe Mike can actually explain why that is.
Yes. They go down 50% of the full range of flap movement. It's just shy of 49%, 50% is the number. And that's because when you get into a really high angle of attack, when the air starts to stall on the back side of your aileron at high angle, it you start to lose your aileron control, and then you're going to drop a wing prior to a full stall, and then that induces the complete stall. So you never want your ailerons to go so far back that you lose flying control. You would rather the flap start to lose first and the plane to sink while you still have full aileron control. So you tend to droop your ailerons only 50% of your flap movement. Let your flaps go first and sink out the aircraft.
Awesome. Well, I definitely, that's another thing we'll see people doing. I know that for a fact, but out of the box, you're not necessarily limited, but you're given kind of a specific setup. You just wouldn't be able to do that droop effect, but that's okay. But people will definitely upgrade and modify their product to how they see fit. Matt, are you still there? No? Sort of. All right, we'll keep trucking along.
Oh, bummer.
So that's all right. So I guess this is a question for Jason. We're getting a lot of questions about Draco being in real flight. So I'll let you take that one.
Yeah, we've decided to not put it in real flight. It's just never. I can't
even. You couldn't even give a straight face.
I'm sorry. I tried. Yes, I mean we've been waiting to put it in real flight, dying to put it in real flight. But I think we've mentioned this before. When we finished the RC model. Once we get it done and we all go out and fly production versions, that's when we start working on the real flight model. And what's cool about real flight models that we make now is it's not just a model that looks like the model. We take the 3D CAD of the actual RC aircraft, we put that into real flight. They skin it, they model it just like it is a 3D model of the aircraft. And then on top of that, they even dump in the source code that we use for the AS3X and safe select settings. All of that is real. The power system is tuned just like the real thing. The prop shape is like the real thing. And so dropping a model into real flight may seem simple, but it's actually a multi-month process. And so it will be in real flight. It will be later this year, but it is a little, we need some time to get it done. We'll put it that way.
All good things come in time. So yeah, it's happening, but we'll get it there. And we want to make sure it's right.
Just 2 years. We just need 2 years. That's all this took.
Hopefully those real flight guys can do a little faster than that. After all, it's just pixels, right? I mean,
yeah, they won't have the challenges that David and Matt had.
Yeah, not at all.
It's good to point out from what Jason's saying, though, you know, the guys really do normally the PD that's the closest to the project spends still a lot of time flying the model on real flight. Many, many hours still go into that to really kind of tune each airplane so they have the same characteristics as they do in real life.
Yeah, no, that's super cool. So I see Craig popping up a couple of comments from Chandra. It looks like, I know you I know you guys are.
She was watching. I should know. My wife's so supportive. I'm a really lucky man. She lets me go home at 3 a.m. and get up at 5 and go back to work. So I have the most supportive, loving wife a guy could ever.
I brought her plane too.
Jason's got her plane.
That is her plane. And if you set that under Draco's wing, that's literally what it would look like when we parked them next to each other. It would sometimes make people nervous when I taxied Draco's wing over the top of a Cub. They're like, wait, don't drive over me. Oh, I guess you can.
But you can.
Yeah, that's one thing I think, and Mike, you probably heard this a lot, but a lot of people don't realize or didn't realize how big it was. I mean, if you look at it next to a Cub, like Jason is holding that, and that's, like you said, that's kind of almost true to scale. It just, I didn't realize it was that big when I saw it at Oshkosh in 2018. I was like, holy crap. it's massive.
It's a big plane. When your head's barely up at the floorboard of the door, you start to realize it's a monster plane. So it was really fun to have a plane that big made out of metal and go play with the fabric aircraft. I'm going to bring it back. I miss it.
Yeah, I bet.
Everybody misses it.
Back right now, I get to play with it between now and when Draco X is done.
Definitely. Well, it sounds like you guys are headed to Sun and Fun soon, Mike, right? Is that heard you guys are going to be doing some cool contests there for folks?
Yeah, so I want to give away a bunch of free stuff, including another Draco. So if anyone's in the Florida area, I'm going to the Sun and Fun Air Show. So what I'm going to do is I have a bunch of silly gear, back to work, scrappy Draco on my website page. And if anyone's wearing that gear, I'm sending my kids around to give away free stuff, including another Draco, maybe a couple, but a bunch of free gear. But I don't want people to have to buy my gear to get free stuff from me. So if you're wearing a shirt that just says anything I might say, or, you know, for the love of flight, take a t-shirt, take a Sharpie out and write on it. Draco, Scrappy, Back to Work, Horizon Hobby, Mike Patey. Just write something that might stand out on a junky old shirt. My kids are going to be looking for you and wanting to give away some free stuff. I love aviation, and the more I've done on YouTube and sharing my passion, it's not what I do for work. This is all about the love of flight for me. This is where I want to spend my time. And so I have so much fun running into people that are wearing Best Tug shirts or my gear. I know that that's someone who loves aviation like I do. So I'm going to be looking for you at the show. And if you're at the show and you see me, come say hi. And if I'm busy or you don't have time or you don't really want to come say hi and strike up a conversation, just yell, get back to work, Mike. And
awesome. Well, I know we'll have a little setup there too. So if you're in the area and you come see Mike, definitely come see Horizon at the event as well. I think Jason will be down there. I'm not sure who else we decided to go yet, but you'll see some of our trade show guys out there. But yeah, I'm sure you'll have RC Draco on display amongst other models. So we're in the planning of that right now. So we're excited to get out there and get to one of our first air shows this year. Mm-hmm. You know, fingers crossed.
Yeah. Hey, Jason. Hit me up, and I'd love to have a time. I want to come hang out at your booth and say hi to people. There's a few people asked if I could do them a favor while I'm down there, Sun and Fun. So maybe we can hook up and have a time that I can hang out at Horizon, and you and I can play with Dracos for a little while together and say hi to some of the people that bring their Dracos by.
Most definitely.
Very cool. Well, Matt, it looks like you're kind of back online, so thanks for trying to figure out your internet situation there. But sorry, you were hard to hear.
He looks frozen, though.
Yeah, he's a little better, but not so good. I will point out, Matt, the silver prop behind you. It's a cool story, because I've seen that in the office forever ago when we used to work out of the office, and now I see it behind you. Tell us a little bit about what that prop is back there.
So this is probably the most terrifying thing I've ever flown on craft in my life. You know, when we were developing the airplane, we started with, you know, CNC props out of like nylon. They just weren't strong enough. We could tell they're de-pitching in flight. We tried printed props, same thing, de-pitching in flight. So the vendor said, hey, I'll CNC a solid aluminum prop for you. and put it on the airplane, and it obviously didn't de-pitch. And we were able to prove the size and pitch we wanted. And, you know, the sound this prop made bolted to an aluminum prop hub on a metal motor kind of had this ringing, singing sound in the air. It was quite allowed us to prove it and get the right prop for this airplane, so it performed exactly like we wanted.
So that is a solid block aluminum Draco prop that no one will ever have but you. Oh, you know, David. Yeah, that's.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
Wow. It that's an expensive really prop, cool too.
It made some really cool noises. Yeah.
Very cool.
So maybe this is a good opportunity to plug that, you know, every week we're going to release a new video that's E-flite Draco related. And so one of the videos that we've got coming up, wink, wink, maybe this coming week, is a video that's behind the innovation, behind the scenes and how we develop Draco. And you guys will see some of the prototypes and some of the testing that they were doing. And it's pretty impressive how far we came and how long it took to get there. But, you know, that aluminum prop, we've never done that ever. We've had to do so many things differently to get this model to the market that it may seem crazy to a lot of people. I'm sure there are people around the office going, I don't know what it is with these guys and this red airplane, but they're always doing crazy stuff with it. But you really got to check out that video. So Wednesday, 11 a.m. Eastern, tune in. It's going to be awesome.
Jason, can you knock one of the lights off in the studio and just kind of walk through some of the blinking lights on it? I think before, not all the lights, just like one of the main set lights, and maybe Alan can pop the lights for you there.
We tried it earlier and it didn't work great because it's all or none. Oh yeah, he's gonna turn on the overhead and then turn out the studio lights, and that might give us a little better idea.
Yeah, before, I don't know if Alan can hear me, but yeah,
there we go. Yeah,
dim, that might help. Yeah, maybe.
Okay. So real quick, I've got them on a knob on my NX8 here, and so they are connected to the light controller through the gear channel, and with the knob, there's the ability to get to all seven options. Now, if you have a three-position switch or a two-position switch, you can adjust which of the options you get, but right now, I've got them off. Everything's off. The inside the instrument panel is lit up right now. That's always lit up because, of course, when you're flying, you want your instrument panel on, and so the first setting here, I'll turn it to. Now you guys will see we've got the nav lights. And so we got the wingtip navs. And then next up, we now have the strobes on with the navs. And then as I scroll through, again, I'm getting more and more lights with each of these positions. And now I've got the landing lights on as well. And the next position here, we've got the down flashers, got the landing light in the nose. And then you guys won't see it because the angle I've got it at, but my next setting is actually the backup light is on. So there is that. And then there's one last setting, which is just solid. Some people don't like the flashing lights, but they want to have most of the lights on. So we have that seventh mode kind of in there for that. And so there's a lot of different modes in the manual. We cover them. And then the nice thing about it is, again, you can have it on a knob or you can put it on a two position or three position switch. So it's really cool.
Yeah.
One of the best parts.
And then we've also got, we'll have a transmitter program out that actually kind of ties it to your flight modes so that you can kind of turn the lights on. You're flying around, putting the flaps down creates the strobes and things to come on, or the landing lights to come on, sorry. And then like Steve was saying earlier, if you hit the reverse, the backup light will come on. So it's all kind of tied into your normal switches that you would use during flight.
Yeah. So cool. So many cool details. And I know those IX and NX radio users will want to see that profile in the preloaded model so they don't have to do all the programming. We're working on it. We'll have it in there soon enough, guys, with a future radio update. But yeah, those lights are awesome. And the lighting in the studio worked well, for the record, Jason.
So it did. That actually did work.
We could see it pretty good in there.
Yeah.
Very cool. Well, let's see. I think, Jason, is there any other features that we should walk through while we're sitting here? Or is there any other questions that you have for Mike while we got him?
Jason, you want to pull a wing off?
Yeah, I should do that. That's probably one of the coolest things that we haven't really shown in anything yet. So I will do that here. And so if I can, I'm going to tilt it up so you guys can hopefully see that there are two thumb screws on the root here.
Hey, I have
on the bottom side.
Way to pull those wings off.
Just kidding. There we go. So if I turn that, it's a quarter turn. That's all it is. So guys, now that we're up close, you can see that. If I just turn it 90 degrees, Now it's unlocked it, and then I can actually wiggle it out of there. Now, when they're new, they're pretty tight, and then over time, they'll loosen up. But, and then you can replace them if needed. But that nice thing is I just pull out these quarter turn thumb screws very quickly. And then, again, also when it's brand new, it's a little tighter, and so it gets a little easier over time. But that's it. Now you guys will see the hands-free connections that we have on the root and on the wing and on the fuselage itself. And the nice thing is all of those connections, they're hard mounted. So you slide the wing in, they make the connection. These are a new V2 design with longer pins and plugs to make sure that the attachment is more reliable. And so that's all it takes to remove the wing panel. And then of course, same thing to install it. So you just slide it onto the tube. We've got a carbon fiber wing tube. We have hard plastic on the inside and of the roots here, so that way it's protected and nice and strong. It slides right into place. Make that connection. You guys probably saw the light come on as I made that connection, and I just slide back in those thumb screws. And what's nice is after you do this a couple times, you can probably do it without having to look. And so you just kind of slide it in there. You can find the right position for it. It snaps into place. I'm saying that as I'm doing it with the hand that I don't normally do it with. So there we go. And that's it. And so that makes it practical for a lot of people to actually own this model that don't normally have the space or the ability to transport a big aircraft like this. And on top of that, it's not a hassle to take apart and put together at the field. And that's a big deal. I don't know if it's because I'm getting old or what, but I don't like when I look at an airplane and I'm like, man, if I take that to the field, it's like 15 minutes of screws and strut pins, and it's not going to take it.
So, yeah, can we get a better shot of the panel again, Jason?
Oh, yeah, let's see if we can get in there.
I'll put it back to the larger screen here.
While you guys are doing that, I'm going to have to sign off. I had so much fun. I've got to catch a flight. I'm out of town for work, and so I'm going to bow out with you guys today. And I've had so much fun. I love you guys. You're just awesome. It's been an absolute blast, and I'm really, really excited you had me join you tonight. And my eyes have been like a little watery because I just nothing, and I'm smiling and I'm happy. Thank you for so much for bringing my red Draco back to life so I can play with it and continue sharing it with the world. So thank you, all of you at Horizon.
Thanks, Mike.
Thank you, Mike, very much. We're very, very honored that you joined us tonight, but more importantly, that you gave us an opportunity to make a model of probably one of the most impactful aircraft there's been in full-scale aviation and RC aviation in the last few years.
Thank you, guys. I'll let you go. Have a wonderful evening, and I'm sure we'll do this again soon. I've had a blast.
Thanks, Mike.
Good night.
Take care. Back to work.
Back to work.
Is that what he said? Cool.
Good stuff. Well, yeah, let's change it up here. I mean, I know we were trying to use Mike's time effectively. We can talk a little bit more about product details. So if you guys have questions in the comments, we've got another, I think we scheduled another half hour on the stream till about 9 p.m. Central here. So if you guys have questions, please put them up. We'll try our best. And Craig behind the scenes, we'll try to throw them on screen. I know one of the questions that I don't know if we answered before was about washout. And maybe David, since Matt's having some internet questions, I mean, was there washout built into this or anything like that?
Yeah, absolutely. There is washout built into the wing. That's for most of our airplanes, we traditionally put some washout in there. It's kind of one of those things that really stabilizes the aircraft. It lets it fly. It lets the wing, I guess you would say the wing tips, kind of like what Mike was speaking of earlier, right? You want the tips of your wings to stay in that airflow as long as you can, because once that's broken, that initiates the full stall, and you know, that's when you lose all your control, basically. So,
yeah, you
know, absolutely, there is some washout in there to try to help stabilize that. You know, this airplane is so unique. The airflow is basically, I mean, it a lot of the times we'll change an airflow to try to make it. You know, we have I would say some go-to airfoils that we normally use, depending on if it's a trainer or a sport plane or whatever. But this one, you know, we kind of decided to give it a shot because it was so unique, and we left it alone, to be honest with you. It's a scaled down version, you know, of that airfoil. So it's very unique, actually, if you look at it from a cross-section view. But we did put a little washout in it to try to help that and kind of you know, kind of stabilize it, I guess you'd say, at slower speeds. But the airplane, you know, again, it's very friendly up, you know, in that kind of higher angle of attack. You know, it's not a 3D airplane where you're going to fly it around on its tail, but at the higher angles of attack and in the slow performance stuff, it's a lot of fun, actually.
Yeah.
And you can definitely see it on that airfoil, especially when Jason had that wing off. You can tell that the leading edge is drooped quite a bit. And then with the slat on top of that, and then you got the outer panels that have an even bigger droop because they're trying to match up with the slat. It really makes a friendly airfoil, especially for high alpha. But again, if you want to make it break and do a snap when you get the inputs into it, it'll do that too, which is really fun.
Another one that's interesting, Alan just panned through, but if you can go back to the stab there, the horizontal tail, you'll see that we actually use the scale inverted slot on, you know, the counterbalance of the elevator too, which is very unusual to see on a model, truthfully.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, and I mean, not only that, I mean, you've got the assembly of the tail. It looks super complex back there. And when I got it out, I was like looking for the screws. Like, you know, I just built like the Focke-Wulf, for example. You know, you got the two little screws. You look at this and you go, there's no screws that hold this in. Click, and it just clicks into place. You're like, that's pretty trick. Nicely done, boys. Yeah. And then you got the little struts that just kind of pop on from a ball link. And I was just like, wow, that was a new thought. So really cool, really cool design.
Jason, I think Chandra wants you to push on the shocks there. She's requesting to see the suspension again. But while we're talking about that, you know, Steve, that's a really good point. That's one that I think all of us at Horizon are, I would say, sensitive to, is we are trying our best to make the customer experience as good as possible and as clean as possible and as simple as possible. You know, we don't, to Jason's point, you know, we don't want you to have to go and look for 15 tools to put your airplane together at the field. Anything we can do to help with that, that's very important to us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're right. I mean,
or it's been grass.
Say that again, Matt.
Or you drop that screw in the grass when you're assembling an airplane or something, exactly. And then it's gone, and you're trying to find a 3mm or something screw for each. This makes it easy. You know, you drop a big red wing screw on this thing, you're going to find it.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. No, it's the build, and I shot some video too, and I know there'll be other videos out there, but a lot of that stuff will come out closer to the release of the product. But yeah, the build was enjoyable. It's certainly longer than most of our recent Bind and Fly releases, just because there's so many details. But by no means was it like daunting, right? You know, if you're a first time beginner, or if you're, you know, someone just coming into the hobby, or you're someone that's been in the hobby for a while, the build was fun. It was enjoyable. It's kind of cool to see how everything clicks together and come out of the box. And the box, Matt, you and I were talking before the show. Just the design in the packaging is spectacular. There's all little bits and pieces, and the way it all kind of works up. It's pretty darn impressive how it all works. So maybe Jason's doing some throttle reversing there for us without chopping his finger off. So be careful, Jason.
The airplane's got so many things sticking off of it. You know, you sit there and look at it, and, you know, like Steve, we were texting earlier, and to, you know, right there on the end of the route, there's the handles for when you're climbing up on the airplane on the real one, right? And the steps on not only the real steps to get in the airplane, but the steps to go up the landing gear. You know, there's a lot of extra pieces on this airplane for sure.
Yeah, that Jason's pointing that up there. I took that little handle, like, you wouldn't even notice that, but after you put it there, like, oh, that looks pretty cool. And it's on the real one. So it's, you know, it's just those little details.
Well, and that's one of the features that Mike probably was the most surprised to see when he got to see the actual model. He goes, oh my gosh, you put that handle. And he'd explain to us why they had that handle, and they couldn't actually reach to fill it if they didn't have it. So that was a pretty cool little detail.
Speaking of Mike, we got Mike in there with his shirt, you know,
and I don't know,
control sticks and everything. I don't think we've shown the full,
the goofy pilot figure. He looks great.
He's got his little Mike Patey shirt on.
I saw a comment yesterday that said, you know, oh, that's not Mike. He's too good looking. It must be Mark.
That's funny. No, it's cool. I mean, I remember that was something you hadn't talked to Mike about, Dave and Matt, and you guys were like, oh, we're gonna surprise him with this model of him in the cockpit. And
yeah,
I mean, what was his reaction when he first saw it?
It was amazing. I mean, to be truthful, you know, the whole time, you know, we were going back and forth, and we would show him a little bit here and a little bit there. And I remember, you know, we got the first tooled one in, and I kind of did this walk around. I got him on the phone, and I was doing this walk around it, you know, to show him some things. And while we were live on the phone, you're talking, and he's laughing and giggling, you know. But every time I'd like try to avoid that window area because I didn't want him to see the pilot. I wanted it a secret. So we kept it a secret the whole time until he first saw it when we went out to visit him. And it was great to see his whole family's reaction was really top of the line. You know?
Yeah, and some of that's in the launch video, you know, his first reaction. And we'll have other videos like Jason mentioned every week that come out. And I think next week is going to be a really cool video that will kind of go more into the details and the behind the scenes of the product. But yeah, you kind of hear Mike talk about it and see his first reaction. It's kind of that almost a tear in your eye moment because you can kind of see how he saw it for the first time and what it meant to him at that point in time. Is just incredible. So yeah, you guys knocked it out of the park. And I just love that pilot figure in there. It's one of those things where you could have completely left it out and left nobody in there and it would have been fine. But just that extra level of detail is just, it's awesome.
You know, let's be real about this, right? It's very challenging sometimes for us to get pilots that look, you know, the part, I guess you would say, when it comes to some of our airplanes. And Matt and I both very early on kind of stuck our feet in the ground, right? And we were like, we're not doing this on this.
I don't think that the public realizes how difficult it's been for us to get pilot figures that look like real people. It's been tough. We'll just say it might seem simple, and everyone always says, oh my gosh, look at the pilot figure. Why does it look like this? And I don't know why it's so difficult. We don't really have the answer to that. We keep trying, and we're getting better.
Even the color of skin, you know, just skin tone, that paint color, yeah. That's like a magic number. It changes.
Make it skin. Time. What color is skin? So yeah, it doesn't even matter if it's a pilot that there's very little exposed face. If it's like, you know, got a helmet on or something, we never get the colors of anything quite exactly right the way we want. So
yeah.
Well,
one of the questions, and this is for the PD guys, maybe Matt, if you're there, you can answer. Can you access the cockpit at all in the airplane, or is it kind of sealed off to the user?
You can actually get to it a little bit. It's not the easiest to get to like where the mic sits in the airplane or like the instrument panel, but there is a rear, Jason's showing it there, the rear window comes off, it's magnetic. And then there's a magnetic foam floor in there which hides the receiver and the light controller. And the cool thing about that is there's no rat's nest of wires in the fuselage. You look in the fuselage, it's clean. You know, everything is hidden beneath a tray or something like that. So it looks like the interior of a full-size airplane, not an RC airplane. But with, you know, a couple of hatches, you have easy access to what you need to get to.
That's pretty cool. So I can put little Mike Patey luggage in the back now.
It's really hard to see, but it actually is. Yeah, it's got the seats. It's got, you know, the control sticks in there. And, you know, to Matt's point, right, it's very clean in there. It's very... you know, it doesn't have a lot of wires just hanging around.
Yeah, very cool. Jason, can you spin it around? Let's do some of the... Oh, sorry. Go ahead, Matt.
Go ahead, Steve. I was just going to say, that's how we're able to get the onboard video. We put a camera right between the two seats, you know, just kind of stuck in there from the back window, you know, kind of wedged it in there, got it where it was a good view, looking like you're a rear seat pilot looking out the airplane.
Mm-hmm. Very cool. Jason, you want to spin it around and do some of the battery bay shots?
Yeah.
Some of the questions on here. People want to see some of that battery bay.
Yeah, I remember earlier this week people were asking, where does the battery go? And I just decided for fun I would tell them it goes in the bottom and in the tail. And oddly enough, some people believed me. And when they saw the finished goods, they're like, oh, wait a second. I can't believe I fell for that. Because who puts the battery in the tail?
It was pretty good. There was there was multiple times people questioned it like, really? It's back there?
That's fun.
Not really. So obviously it does go in the nose. The nice thing is it's not that far ahead of the CG. So although the battery does have some impact on the CG, it's not like completely radical. And that's why I've got in here a 6S4000, which I've flown a lot. And I really like this battery because I use this in a lot of my 70 millimeter EDF jets and even some of my 80 millimeter EDF jets. And then I've got that battery for here. It's a nice lightweight 6S setup. And then of course, I think the most popular, the most common battery that guys are going to fly is going to be that 6S5000. That's by far the best all-around performance, in my opinion. It's got good flight time. It's got good power, good performance. A lot of guys already have these batteries from a lot of other applications. But then on occasion, especially if there's a little bit of wind, I love flying with a 7000. That's the sweet spot for me with a little bit of wind. It's a little heavier, of course. You feel that. But also, I'm getting like easily 10 to 15 minutes, sometimes even 18, 20 minutes, shooting touch and goes with a 7000. It's pretty awesome. Pretty impressive.
So, funny comment.
Yeah, and one of our product developers during the testing. Oh, go ahead, Steve.
Sorry. No, I just that cracked me up. Now I have to make little scale Diet Coke cups.
Absolutely. Diet Coke cups. It's coming up.
We're doing it. Of I'm going to start 3D printing that tonight. Don't worry about it.
I love it.
I was just saying
that. Give us all the secrets. During testing, this is going to be great.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So I basically wide open it with a 6S5000. It's a five-ish, just a little bit more airplane, a 5-minute airplane. One of the product developers here, when he was test flying it, flew it with a 6S5000, got 18 minutes just doing touch and goes. So it really depends on how you fly the airplane as to your flight time. A 7000, if you're just doing touch and goes, you could probably stretch to 20. A 4000, you could probably stretch to 15 or so. So it's a very versatile platform depending on how you fly it. If you go wide open, yeah, it's gonna suck that battery down. But if you're just doing touch and goes, cruising around, you can really stretch out that flight time.
Very
what
cool.
What charger?
So, yeah, what do you think, Jason? I know what you're gonna say. You certainly can use a lot of different chargers out there, but of course, if you're gonna ask us.
So the nice thing is, and we haven't touched on this directly, but some people probably have already picked up on this, although 6S works and by far is probably what most people will use, a 5S battery is fine, even a 4S battery. I've flown it a lot with 4S 5,000 milliamp batteries. The flight time is a little shorter because you're on the power a little bit more, but it's a really floaty, nice scale experience. It's less than scale Draco power, but it's like probably what a full-scale Wilga has and or a full-scale Stoll aircraft of a similar capability. And so I use that 4S 5000 on low wind days, like a nice evening. I just go out and cruise around nice and slow and easy. I've flown it on 5S. On 5S, it's very similar to a full-scale Draco. And then on 6S, of course, it's better than full-scale power. And so that's what dictates your charger, depending on the battery you're going to use. My favorite charger now, though, is this. This is the best one.
Yeah, buddy. That's what I got.
S2200. It's two ports, 200 watts per port, or you can bias up to 380 watts on one port, so you can charge your 6S 5000 battery in 20 minutes. It depends on how comfortable you are with higher C charge rates. I don't mind. I've been doing it for a long time, and 2C, 3C doesn't really hurt the battery as long as you got a good, safe charger. I know a lot of guys are saying, hey, you guys are promoting this smart stuff that's proprietary, that's I don't need all that. No, of course you don't need all that. But if you're new to the hobby, especially, there's no need now to learn all the things that you had to learn to charge safely. We don't even have a balance connector on the G2s, which I know is a point of contention for some people. We have that third smart wire. You plug it in the charger. It knows exactly what the battery is based on that third data lead. And it charges it appropriately. You don't have to set the charger. Now, we also then sell the G1 batteries, which have the balance connector. And we're going to continue selling those for many years to come because we know some people prefer that. But my favorite aspect of smart batteries, and I'm sure every single one of you guys will agree, is self-discharging to storage. I'm so happy that I don't have to rush home all the time and discharge my batteries for storage.
Another note, Jason, is on the charger, no adapter leads, right? We've got
five
right there on the front of the charger now. We've got the door, so... Either one you want to charge, you're there at the field. You don't have to look for a lead.
That makes it so convenient from going to, park flyer to a larger Carbon Z or Draco sized airplane or EDF, you name it, something with an IC5 to an IC3. It's just seamless. And again, you don't have to bring any extra accessories to the field to make it work.
Yeah, and we do still have the balance port if you have a G1 battery or a non-smart LiPo. The smart chargers will charge every battery you can possibly imagine. And so there's a lot of benefit to buying a smart charger for smart batteries, but then you're not restricted to only using it with smart batteries. And by the way, this one is the Bad Mamma Jamma. This is the single port 400 watt up to 20 amps. So yeah, you can charge some 6S 7000 batteries pretty fast. I'd have to do the math real quick, but I think that's almost 2C on a 7000 you can get out of this guy. It's pretty impressive.
Yeah.
And it's really, you know, it's great to experience that whole package, right? With, you know, with the DRACO, you get so much new smart technology between, you know, now you can see your screen for your safe select. Now you can see your screens for, you know, your battery charge and what it's doing. You know, there's so many new features packed into that airplane and what Jason's got there on the table with the chargers, the batteries, even the transmitter, right?
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. I like this comment, and I really thought to myself, how can I make that? And I pulled up a picture of the best tugs, and I was like, RC best tug.
I will admit that Jason and I took pictures of a tug while we were there.
Well, 3D boys, print. Where's it at?
Yeah, 3D print.
Oh, that'd be
awesome. His tugs do look very, very nice. They're very finished looking pieces of equipment, right? You know, a lot of the times that's just a mechanical piece you don't think much about, right? It just sits in the corner of your hangar. These things they've got bodies on them and they're clean and just they're very finished looking pieces.
Yeah, well, showing a little bit of the telemetry there, and that's going to be something that we're going to cover all of these details, guys, in a couple of videos down the road where we walk you through assembling the model. We talk about setting it up on a spectrum radio. We show you how the telemetry works. That'll be a lot of content for people that are really serious about the model and want to know everything about it, and that'll be out a couple weeks from now.
Very cool. So let's talk a little bit. We got about 15 or so minutes left. And I think one of the big comments, and I think Craig's been answering it a lot, is when is this going to be available? And this is a specific type of launch for Horizon. This will be a little bit different than we've done things in the past. Of course, it's going to be a first come, first serve scenario. So, you know, we've got our retail partners to support. We've got the consumers that are online to support. But what we're doing is it's called a coordinated launch. And it's very similar to how like a video game is launched, or certainly, you know, the iPhone is launched, for example. There's a specific day that they'll be available, you know, globally. So the models will be available in store and online to ship on the same day. So they're going to be, you know, April 20? I don't want to say it wrong. 23rd, Jason, is that right?
April 23rd. That's the day. That's DRACO Day.
So put it on your calendars now. If you got your order in super early, you'll be in the first batch, and if not, then there'll be more following up right away. But yeah, April 23rd is the big day, so make sure to get that out there. So put it in your calendar and get your orders in, whether it's at your local hobby shop or online. It'll be available, you know, at the same time everywhere. So pretty cool.
Yeah, it's definitely different than we've done it before. And the goal here was to make sure that everybody could kind of get their hands on it at the same time. You know, one thing that we've noticed over the years is that some guys get bummed out when they pre-ordered the same time their buddy did, but they live a little bit further away from their hobby shop and they can't get there right away. And so by having this coordinated launch, the hobby shops will have it the same day. We'll start shipping it to customers the day before. And so most people that ordered one or pre-ordered one in this case will actually get it in their hands the same day or within a day or two of that. And so it just kind of evens it out for everybody instead of having that that feeling of, oh man, there's already guys posting on YouTube their videos and I haven't even gotten mine yet. So we're trying to do things a little different. And Steve made a good point that a lot of our retailers also pre-ordered, and some of them probably have extra units that haven't been spoken.
Absolutely.
So if you want to get a DRACO on DRACO Day, we should call it that, right? It's DRACO Day.
I'll go submit the National Day paperwork right now. National DRACO Day.
So for DRACO Day, you're going to then, if you have a shop that has an available open, you know, kind of pre-order slot, again, reach out to them, check with them. A lot of them yesterday ordered first thing in the morning. As soon as they saw it, they know you guys are going to want it. They may not even have waited for customers to come in and ask for it. And so be sure to check there. We did sell out through our website for the immediate, you know, pre-orders, but we have shipments coming in constantly. You know, like every couple of weeks we'll have a little bit more and a little bit more. So a real important point there is if you missed out on getting a pre-order in the first shipment, don't not pre-order. Don't not back order. Make sure you put your order in. That puts you in line. Yeah. If otherwise, you may never get in line to where as we get shipments in and ship them out, you're going to be further and further down the list the longer and longer you wait. So yeah, make sure to get in that pre-order, back order line.
Yeah, that's a great point, Jason. And the point you made earlier about the dealers having it, you know, our retail partners order these things sometimes in the 5 to 10 at a time, right? And so, you know, the bigger retailers are going to have more, of course, and the smaller shops will have a couple. But again, that's just depending on their local market. So if you've got a great dealer and you want to support them, make sure to get in line, talk to them, say, hey, I want to put a deposit down or whatever, work with them. Yeah. And make sure you get in line, because this is setting the world on fire as far as the RC industry, and there is quite a bit of them being sold. So you definitely want to get your place in line to get your hands on one. And if you don't get in the first shipment, check around, call different retailers. Do your best to call around and say, hey, you got a Draco, got a Draco. And I'm sure our retailers will appreciate that and work with you to get something as well. But yeah, absolutely. We've definitely sold a few Dracos over the last day or so. So cool.
Woodford wants a Draco.
Yeah, I think he wants a PO, actually.
Oh, no.
Yeah. He's telling me, hey, I want to go out. You've been on this call for 2 hours. Let's go.
Yeah. Yeah. So how is I'm just curious, what is probably the number one question that we've seen, and did we answer that? I'm not actually seeing the comments on my feed here.
What's the number one question? Did we cover that?
The number one question? I think we've covered it. I mean, there's some other ones that I haven't questioned. Someone said, what about floats? And I think the answer there is no, we didn't quite design floats for it. I'm sure it could be done. Another one I saw that that was not covered, which was, how are the tires attached? How are the wheels attached? I just built it, and you guys can answer this obviously, but it's a a threaded shaft and a nylon lock nut that holds that on, and then that goes into the landing gear assembly. So I hope that answers that question. And if I answered it wrong, guys, feel free to jump in there. But I think
you're good. And yeah, unfortunately, we didn't plan the floats in, but we have tried it on skis. It will work on skis, so we have tried that.
There's footage on that. Yeah, I remember Ali telling me about the skis, and he said, well, it's pretty darn good. It works really well. So I can't wait to see that. Obviously, all the snow's melted here now, but we'll get it out.
Thank goodness. Year.
Thank goodness. Let's not.
So, Jason, can you show us how soft of the tires are? That's a question that just popped up.
Yeah. So obviously getting tires that are not too soft, that they're not durable, and that they're too hard, that they're not shock absorbing to some degree, these are very similar to the timber wheels, timber tires. I think, right, Matt? They're very similar in density to those.
Yeah, absolutely. The one thing we did different on these is the wheels are actually glued to the hub to make sure they're much more secure, because of the rough terrain the airplane can fly off of. I mean, you watched where David landed. You watched some of the places I landed here. I mean, we're going over rocks. We're going over huge side loads on these tires. And the tires on most of these airplanes, other than being covered in dirt, because we're landing in some crazy fun places, look as good as they would pull them out of the box, unless you go over something really nasty. I don't think you're going to hurt them.
I think it's good to point out too, right, that it's not just the tires taking the load on this aircraft, it's the tires and the shocks. I know that's a sensitive subject to a lot of our customers, right? Is soft tires, hard tires? And it's an argument. It's almost like Ford and Chevrolet or something, right? But when it comes right down to it, we do look at that a lot. We focus on it a lot, but it's very hard to, make one tire fit all, right? Some airplanes handle much better on hard tires, especially on hard surfaces. There's a lot that goes on with that. So in this case with the Draco, you've got so much suspension travel with the shocks and things like that, that the tires themselves are they're really not taking much of the load, truthfully.
Yeah.
And on top of that, you got the carbon gear flexing too. So you got the carbon gear, you got the shocks, you got the tire absorbing stuff. So you got like this whole system absorbing shock loads of landing in rough surfaces.
Yeah. Yeah. To Matt's point, it's one of the, I would say one of the only times, I mean, a lot of you guys know who Ali is, he's one of our developers, and with all of us out there testing, to Matt's point, we dropped this thing from head high, and it's one of the only times I've ever heard Ali go, oh, like, he was expecting the bad thing to happen, but it bounced. It kept on going.
Now, when it comes to landing with, you know, the added shocks and those softer tires, I mean, is it a bouncy ride, or is it really, obviously depends on how you put it down, but is it a little bit more bouncy than normal?
I think it depends on how you put it down and where you put it down. Absolutely, right? So if you're on asphalt, you know, and it's kind of the whole crosswind thing, you'll experience kind of that bounce and skip kind of thing sometimes, and it'll lean into the wind and things like that. But, you know, I think it really depends on the terrain you're in at the time. Obviously, in just normal grass, it kind of just kind of cushions and goes.
Okay.
And yeah. to what Mike was bringing up earlier, right? You know, it's all about how you land it too, right? If you land it on the mains, it's going to expect more of an accurate soft touchdown than if you three-point it and, you know, kind of basically stall it out to the ground.
Especially gotcha. With that high yeah. lift wing. You know, you get any angle attack, it's going back in the air.
Fair, yeah. Good point, Matt.
So I will say it's not hard to land at all. You know, a lot of people who have some experience are going to say, oh, it's a pussycat. To be able to land it like we talked about, maybe a little bit more high alpha, where you're kind of trying to drag the tail and land it, that's going to take the right skill level because you have to manage your throttle and your elevator and everything just right. So I wouldn't expect that everybody's going to be able to look like Mike Patey on their first couple landings. But again, not hard to land, not hard to fly. But one quick point that I want to make is that even though it's very easy to fly, relatively speaking, for an RC model, if you have a couple models under your belt, you can fly this no problem. Especially the Bind and Fly Basic version with Safe Select, which are the angle limits, so you can't get upside down and crash. And if you let go of the stick, it goes back to level, kind of like an autopilot to some degree. Even though it has that, it's not for a beginner RC pilot. If you've never flown an RC aircraft before, we don't recommend starting here. You could, and you know, some guys might succeed, and that's why we do the ultimate combo, because it comes with everything you need to fly it, even if you don't have anything. Also, it comes with a real flight simulator because we want you to practice on that first. But that's why I brought this today, the Carbon Cub, because this is what you should learn to fly. This is perfect, right? What do you guys think? I think this is one of our best trainers ever.
No, I completely agree. And it's set up as a trainer, right? So as Jason mentioned, our Draco has Safe Select, right? It's kind of the intermediate to experience kind of side of things. But the Cub there has Safe, which is set up just as specifically as a trainer, right? It allows you to walk through the process and kind of grow with your skills.
Yeah, no, excellent trainer, you know, super easy to fly. You can essentially hand it to anybody and they'll be successful. If you're in a large enough area, obviously when you're learning to fly, you don't want to be around trees and whatnot. They can't avoid that stuff. But you know, as far as the gentle nature of a Cub, and then you add an extra layer of all the technology that we slap in there, and you've got this just super success machine, as I like to call it. You know, you can just hand it. We do at RC Fest, when we can have the event, we put a bunch of these in the air. This or the Aero Scout. I mean, this has a scale look to it, which is great. But it's, you know, it definitely is that just awesome. And it's a tail dragger, but it's a great trainer. It really is. It doesn't need to be a tricycle landing gear plane. Oh, and you've got all that on there.
There are optional flaps, also optional floats, and even optional GPS, which has the virtual fence, which is pretty cool. And so, yeah. Oh, and like Mike said earlier, you know, Mike used to fly the full scale Draco, and Chandra would be flying her full scale Carbon Cub, which happens to be this exact same paint job. And so if you really want to complete the set, if you're buying a Draco, you should buy one of these too.
The ultimate salesman, Jason. You're the ultimate salesman.
Well, you start with the Cub and then you can work up to the Draco, right?
That's right. Or buy two Dracos, put one in your room and don't fly it, and then use one to fly.
It makes a great display model also. So you need one to fly and one to hang in your office hangar, wherever, right?
Yep, of course.
So two questions. Are the shocks oil filled? The answer is no. And then the other one was, yeah, they're just a spring inside there, right, Matt? It's just kind of a pretty stiff spring.
Yeah, it's a plastic shock body with a piston in there. And, you know, actually when Mike changed, if you watched a lot of Mike Patey's videos, you know, he actually had a suspension failure on Draco where he had the single shock and then converted to these dual King shocks. And that actually made our life as a modeler much easier developing this airplane, because it made the gear much more stable, much stronger, able to support more load. So it ended up being a better gear because of his changes that we saw. And we're like, oh, we're doing that.
Yeah, it definitely was. Yeah, and that was one thing we didn't talk about a lot tonight, but as Mike was going through his YouTube process, you know, of showing the build, every new video came out, you guys were like, oh, we got to add that now.
Oh, yeah.
It was funny to watch.
Yeah.
Someone all of us would be watching it on our computers at the same time. As soon as he'd post it, we'd be like, did you see this? Did you see this?
Back Jason's to the drawing board on the model.
Jason's got the stinger in his hand. So it's just a plug-in piece of wire. There's no screws, nothing. It's just a press fit, you know, tension fit right into the wingtip there. So
yeah, so if for whatever reason you needed to remove it, you can, either for transport or storage. I actually do take mine off for storage, because if you don't, the wing panel is kind of sitting up. And then I also have accidentally, taking one wing panel out of my rack, it's scratched on the stinger. So I actually pop mine out somewhat often. Also, I found if you do that, you might need to bend the U a little bit so that A, it's not too tight, B, it's not too loose. So it's easy to do. It's just music wire. So yeah, these things are great. They look cool and they actually work.
Yeah, they are definitely very functional. I mean, I've scraped many a wingtip on this airplane during testing. And the worst case that happens, if you're full aileron the wrong way, you might just catch the tiniest corner of your aileron, but it protects your wingtip. You know, many other airplanes, you start scuffing it, you get that asphalt mark on your wingtip, or in grass, it catches and makes it even worse. These things are not only just for, you know, a cool factor, but they're functional.
Mm-hmm. All right. We're over our time limit here, but we'll answer as many last questions as we can. Last one here on the screen, are the exhaust ports metal or just shiny plastic? They're indeed. Is that just like a chrome plating plastic, basically, guys? Is that what that is?
Yep, exactly.
Yeah. And then this one we haven't answered, but let's talk about speed a little bit. What's the range that you guys are seeing? I don't know if we've radared it yet, or if you know.
We haven't done the top speed yet.
I can't. Did we? I can't remember, but I would say it's definitely over 40. It's actually got a pretty broad speed range.
Yeah, that power system is very efficient. It has a great sound in the air. It has almost a turboprop sound, which is very appropriate for this airplane. But the top end is pretty decent. I'd say it's definitely over 40. I'd probably almost say 50 or 60, wide open, you know, straight and level. Maybe a touch more. But again, that wing is not made to go super, super fast, as Mike was alluding to earlier. You know, it's an under-cambered wing that's trying to go 180 miles an hour in real life. So it definitely needs the power to do it because of the high drag, because of the lift. But I think our model emulates the real thing is about as good as you can.
Definitely. What about this question? AS3X gains and settings available to those who want to program the 8 channel and split ailerons and flaps. What about that?
Is 8 channels enough to do it?
Yeah, that's true.
I think it is. If you just want the full span aileron flap combo, right?
Correct. Because I guess if you wanted to use flaps as ailerons, maybe not, depending on how you want to kind of do things. But to just do split ailerons to kind of tie into the flaps, like we were talking about earlier, yeah, we could do it in 8 channels. Yeah.
Yeah. So at the moment, though, we don't have a way to load a file from one of our receivers into another receiver. You can duplicate the gains and the safe settings that you can access through forward programming, but that's not everything. So we are working on that, and down the road, you'll be able to load receiver files. And maybe David knows, I'm assuming down the road that you could load a 6-channel file into an 8-channel receiver potentially.
Correct. Yeah. Down the road, we will be able to do that. And, I'll go ahead and say it. Down the road, once we do that, I'll put some effort in and go ahead and just make a model file that has the split ailerons in it. And that way, you guys can just load it up. We'll do a transmitter and receiver model file. And that way, you'll already be done. So,
yep. And this question here, are the leading edge slats removable?
That's a good question, actually. We've always, over the years with our timber models, we've talked about making them to where you can actually take them on and off, but there's really no way to do that practically without having it add a ton of weight, a ton of cost, a ton of complexity. So they do glue on. They're just like your typical timber slat. So you've got the plastic standoffs. I'm assuming there's 5 or 6, probably Matt knows off the top of his head. So you do need a little bit of glue for assembly to install these. And then also to install the little scale details like the handles here and then the antennas. But it's not much glue. I was done building it in like 30 minutes. And I use some foam safe CA. You can also use the foam to foam that we recommend, which is kind of a lot like a foam tack or something along those lines.
Another note about those slats is you know, that those are a little different in the fact that Mike designed that wing with those. That's not really an option or a bolt on. That was part of the actual design. You'll notice that the tips of the wing actually kind of follow that same airfoil, but don't have the slat there when he added the extensions. But those are, you know, kind of part of that whole design in that wing.
And then this question, UMX Draco? Yeah, these questions are, I always love these questions, although we always can't give you an answer, right? We can't talk about future products. You know, we're thinking it. That's the one thing you know, but we can't talk about the future. We do know that the excitement around this product would make sense to look at future products, but we can't certainly talk about it. So thanks for the question. I know a lot of people actually answered that or asked that question, but like all of our responses to future models, it's kind of a tight-lipped ship around here. And hopefully we get to do it. I'll just say that.
I'd say maybe.
We didn't show the counterbalances, Jason.
That's a good point. Yeah, maybe Alan can help us show that, which it is functional on the ailerons. I did unplug it, but it's pretty impressive. And I think that was another one of those details that Mike was super impressed by, was the fact that we actually have those in there and they are weighted. Mm-hmm. So there's actually brass weights inside that counterbalance, and it does its job, what it's supposed to do. And it looks the part and it works the part. And it just bolts on real quick. Absolutely. And easy.
It is definitely a fully functional part of that airplane. It functions exactly like a full-size counterbalance would work on an airplane.
Definitely. Well, I'm trying to get everything, guys. I apologize if I missed it. Just a couple of things that I think we can't answer, that like this one. But I think, you know, for the most part, I think we covered a lot. And the one question that I think we got a couple times that we didn't answer, is there a single, we'll end with this. How about this? Is there a single feature on here that we didn't show tonight that you guys think that the world needs to know? Is there some kind of Easter egg or some little feature that we just didn't quite point out? I think we covered everything, to be honest, but you guys, UPD guys, can you think of anything?
I think we covered the highlights, don't you think, Matt? I mean, I really do. I mean, you know, I think, you know, kind of like I think Jason mentioned it earlier, which is every time you look at it, I think you're going to see something else, right? It's
detail
type of airplane. Mm-hmm. But you know, I think that's the cool part about it, is I think it's definitely an airplane I feel like you can take to the field and be very proud of, and you know, want to show off to your buddies.
Yeah. It's a big old motor, that's for sure. I don't think you could see it because it's covered halfway by the cowl, but imagine that motor goes almost all the way up to the front of the cowl here. It is no tiny little thing. It's a beast of a thing.
And even the prop, you know, Matt mentioned earlier, we tried a long time. We wanted a scale prop, right? I mean, it's not a prop we bought off the shelf. You know, the blade shape, the looks, everything about it, we wanted to make it match the real airplane.
Yeah. So a few things that we talked about but didn't show, and we can't really show in this video, you'll see in some of the other videos, is like what I think impressed Steve tonight, putting his together, that the stab slides in and clicks. And it's then solidly mounted. You also have the struts that pop onto some ball links. But in theory, if you wanted to break it down for storage and transport and remove the tail, it would only take three ball links, the elevator link, and then the two that secure the struts. And then you pull the latch up and it slides right out. Pretty impressive.
Yeah, it was like just like bloop. The elevator's done.
Yeah, and the struts fold against the stab, so they're not going to poke into anything during transport. They'll actually sit right against the surface of the stab, so they're not, you know, like hanging down.
Yeah,
it works. It's a really nice system that worked really well, and allows you, you know, especially if you're going to an event or something like that, where you're carrying a bunch of airplanes and you need to break it down. You know, pull the gear off, pull the stab off, pull the wings off. Pull the prop off, you can fit this in a tiny area for transport.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, for sure.
So it is not an aluminum spinner. It looks like it, though. You guys did a great job on getting good color paint on here and a nice material that makes it look the part. Because look at that. It looks like it.
In the studio lights, it's got like the exact aluminum shine.
It's a machine to it, doesn't it? Yeah.
It's pretty cool. All right. Well, guys, I am so, I know we're all super excited, and I'm really happy to be lucky enough to be able to go out and fly this guy tomorrow, hopefully, if the weather's good. And I know all of you out there that have tuned in tonight, we appreciate your excitement. We appreciate you guys placing your pre-orders and supporting this product, Mike and his channel, and all of the this awesome achievement. Kudos to you guys and the development team and anybody involved at Horizon to help make this product come to reality. Most of you out there don't realize the size of the team that we have working on products, but when it comes to something like this, you know, us four here tonight, we're just a little bit of the team, and you know, there's a lot more players behind the scenes that don't get the glory of getting on the live show. So if you're any employees out there watching, thanks so much for all your support, whether you're in the creative team, the purchasing teams, the finance teams, the warehouse, getting these out of the warehouse. I mean, it takes an army, and we appreciate all your hard work, but we do it all for you guys out there watching. So thanks so much to all of our customers. Jason, thank you for staying at the studio super late. I hope you don't set the alarm off tonight, so make sure you get out of there.
That was last night.
Jason almost got arrested last night for you guys setting up that Draco. I got a call this morning from an angry CFO, and it was all good, but it's okay. He did his job.
I'm sitting at my desk watching a YouTube video on radio stuff, and I hear clank, 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 and I look, and there's a cop.
It's so easy to do. You don't know you do it.
Jason, I had no idea.
Both been offenders of this. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's so, good that your desk is right by the window, Jason.
Yeah. I could tell that he felt bad because I probably looked like I was going to have a heart attack. Because it's not the time of day/night that someone should be in an office building with the lights on at their desk watching YouTube videos building an airplane.
Well, appreciate your hard work and dedication, all of you guys. Thanks so much for tuning in, everybody. I guess that's it. Any last words from anybody?
You got to get one, guys. I know that there's a lot of people who are still on the fence. There's a lot of people who are not on the fence, and that's awesome. But I really think that when you see it in person, that's when you'll probably get off the fence and you'll kick yourself for not getting off the fence earlier. Yeah, this is not an airplane that a lot of people would have ever thought of when, you know, they were dreaming about airplanes. And I think that's pretty much what took everybody by surprise. When Mike created it, he changed the perception of, well, a Wilga, which is already a not terribly attractive airplane, but he made it cooler looking. And then on top of that, the story behind it, and then the things that he added to it to add the performance, and then those translate very well over to this model. It really is a unique flying experience. It makes you feel cool flying it. I don't know how to explain it. I've flown a lot of airplanes for a long time, and this is just special. Like every time, I'm excited to go fly it constantly. I get bored with a lot of airplanes very quickly to where I'll take them out a couple of times. I feel like I mastered it, but I'm gonna take this one out all the time, not only because it's enjoyable to fly, but it feels special in a lot of ways.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, definitely brings a warmth to your heart. And, you know, I feel like a little tingle every time we get together and talk about this thing. It's been a fun experience. So very cool. Well, David, thanks so much.
Thanks for having us.
Absolutely.
All right, guys. Yeah, well, we're going to go ahead and sign off now. And we'll don't forget to sign up for everything and then check out the video that comes out next week. And it's going to be a good couple weeks of good content on the Draco. Thanks, everybody. Have a great night.
Good night.
Good night.